And here's the new guy.
Oh, hey guys.
How's it going?
How's it going? It's good to see you.
Yeah, we just wanted to say hi. Looks like Drew's still getting settled, but
we're so glad. I know it's a mess. I know I'm still just trying to get like organized and settled in, but you know what? I've got this thing. I got my lamp.
That is a nice lamp.
It's a super cool
John
lamp.
812. Yeah. We almost had that for our wedding verse.
Super good verse. I thought it would be appropriate. You know, Concordia, the beacons, that whole thing. Light, walking in the light.
Light of the world.
Jesus says.
Yeah.
So, you know.
So good.
Yeah. But cool. Anyway, no, it's pretty much the best lamp that's ever been invented, I think. So
I agree.
Made sure it was the first thing I set up.
So nice. Yeah. Good call. That's awesome. Hey, if you need anything, let us know.
Okay.
But we're so happy you're here.
We'll do.
Yep.
That sounds good.
Yep. Yep. Okay.
That sounds good. All right.
We'll talk to you later.
Perfect.
Nice
plan. See you later. Thanks.
Okay, Sarah. I don't know what it is about that lamp.
What lamp?
The lamp you just told him was the coolest lamp in the world.
That
lamp is really cool. It's so cool. Did you see it?
Well, I've had that plan.
I gotta have it.
Did you say? Go take it and calm down, but go take it.
Right. That's a good idea. I'm just gonna take it. He doesn't need it. What does he need it for? He's got a big window in there.
And he's only been here a week. So
yeah, he doesn't need his lamp.
Go take the
lamp. I need his lamp. Okay, I'll take it.
Okay, will you just stay watch? He just left a few minutes ago.
Okay. Oh, it's so cool. It doesn't even plugged in. He does not need this.
Oh, I love it. I love it. I love it. I love it. I love it.
Hey, ladies.
Hey there, Tim.
Cool lamp.
Thank you. I think it'll look really nice in my classroom.
Yep.
John 8:12, follow the light, right?
Such a good verse.
Yeah. Awesome. So you ready for the start of the new year?
Yep, ready. Yep.
Ready or not, here we go.
Yep. It'll be good.
See you later.
Bye.
We
Hey, bro, Sarah. What's up? Oh, sorry. Gotta get in better shape. Anyway, hey, you guys know that super sweet lamp that I was showing you earlier in my classroom?
So nice.
Yeah, super cool. Like coolest lamp you've ever seen in your life. Anyway. Yeah. So weird thing, I went back to my classroom and all of a sudden it was gone. And like, I don't know where it went. So you guys haven't seen it at all, have you?
Have you seen it?
Nope.
Okay. Cause I trust the two of you more than anybody here at Concordia Academy right now. And that lamp was actually, it's a gift from my great aunt Ethel. You know how I love my Ethy Wethy. So anyway, if you see it, would you guys just let me know? Okay,
sure.
Just let me know.
Yeah,
okay.
If we see it, we will let you know.
All right, you guys have a good
luck.
Day.
We
see
hope you find it.
We're supposed to do, but it was Effie
Westies.
Super upset about it, and also Tim saw us with that lamp.
I know he was mad, but now if it just appears, but it's just gonna appear. Like, what am I supposed to do?
Yeah, you're right. We can't give it back because that would be ridiculous if right after he sees us and then we go put it back. I think
it's
that
gonna
we
be
should
so cool in my classroom. What?
Destroy it. Destroyed the evidence. Nobody knew it was gone. Nobody knew that we had it. Nobody knew that you destroyed it.
I guess I can't put it back.
It's the only thing we have.
Where am I going to destroy it?
I think you should smash it somewhere quiet where nobody's going to hear. Rebecca's choir room.
Oh, that's a good idea.
Yeah,
that's a good idea. Okay, yeah. Okay. Come on. Okay.
Nobody's in here. This is the quietest room in this blood fridge or soft room. Break it down. Do it. Nobody's going to hear you.
Okay.
Not against the wall, but it's going to be too loud on the carpet. Break it. Break it.
Like, okay, it's okay. Where are we? Brooke, what did you do? What did I do? What did you do? You told me to smash it.
But you
You told me to.
Oh my God. You were the one to
but
do
you
it.
You told me to smash it.
I've been waiting for you.
What is that? Who are you?
I've been watching you two. Waiting for you to make a mistake. Waiting for you to stumble. And to think, all it took was a silly little limb. But that's how it happens sometimes. The little things. The easy things. Those can be the biggest trap sometimes. And now, you're stuck here. Trapped in my realm of darkness.
What is this place? What? Where are we?
Don't worry. You are right where you belong. Surrounded by darkness. Hidden in the ways of the world. And mired in your disobedience.
You have to get out of here. Run! 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 No! Run! Run!
You cannot escape. You see, no escape. You belong here. Four, please. This is the world you live in now, you thieves, you liars, slanderers.
Oh, where's my lamp? Where's my lamp? Oh, man. I just wish I had my lamp. Oh, Ethy, Wethy, I have failed you. Wait. What is this? This is my lamp. So somebody destroyed my lamp. Somebody smashed my beautiful, precious lamp. Oh my goodness. What is this thing? It's disgusting. It looks so evil. I have to tell somebody. I have to find somebody.
Tim, I need your help. I've never seen anything like it. You gotta come and follow me. I gotta show it. It's in the choir room. I'll show you. I've never seen anything. I know what it is.
Okay. I'll help. Calm down. But just remind me, who are you again?
Andrew? Andrew Ask? New campus pastor? You hired me.
Oh.
We interviewed multiple times.
Yeah, okay. Yeah.
Oh, Andrew. Yeah.
Yeah.
So anyway, there's this thing I have to show. It's in the choir room. It's super creepy. I've never seen anything like it. And, I don't know. It's your school. I've never been, like.
Okay. Fine. Let's go.
Okay. Goodbye.
New guys. I need.
So I had this amazing lamp. Best lamp you've ever. You should see this lamp. It's the nicest lamp you've ever seen in your entire life. But anyway, so it was gone. It was missing. I didn't know where it went. So I went to start looking for it. And then I came in here and I found it and it's shattered, but I also found this.
I've seen this before and it is not good.
What is it?
Hey, your lamp. Did your lamp have a Bible passage on it?
Well, yeah, John 8:12. It's my favorite, following Jesus in light.
Andrew, I'm afraid your lamp isn't just missing. I think it was stolen.
Stolen?
I saw Sarah and Josephine with it earlier today.
Ugh. Those lying thieves! I knew it wasn't just missing, and I trusted them more than anybody at Concordia Academy!
Listen. I know you're upset, but I think Sarah and Josephine may be in grave danger. Something they did with when they broke this lamp, it opened a portal into a dark and dangerous place.
Well, you know, if you ask me, sounds like they got what they deserve.
You don't understand. There, this place that they are, it's called the Upside Down. And it's a place that consumes, it destroys, it eats everything and everyone that enters it. We may not see them again.
What do we do? What do we have to do?
I don't know. We've got to do something to try and help them.
What can we do?
Wait, I have an idea. Here, quickly, come with me. So the Upside Down, it's not unlike our world. In fact, it's like our world in every way, but it is ruled by darkness, fear, and death. So it'll look the same for Sarah and Josephine. They would have soon discovered that they couldn't get out, that they couldn't escape. So they would have probably looked for a place of comfort, of safety, somewhere to hide.
I bet they went to Josephine's classroom.
Hurry. Lock the door. Sarah, that's not gonna work. It opens up. Oh, it's just hide. Fine, we're okay. We're totally dead. How are we ever gonna get out of here? What are we gonna do? Oh, it's so gross under here.
That is a lot of gum.
Students, what are you doing?
Now, it is extremely difficult to communicate with people in the Upside Down. But there's always one thing that can cut through the darkness, the light. So we need to find a way to communicate with them using light.
The projector. We can use the projector to write messages to them in the Upside Down.
Yeah, let's go.
Okay, what should I write?
We need to somehow get them back to the choir room where the portal is. We need to get them to follow the lights.
We can use Christmas lights. We'll line Christmas lights all the way down the hallway and lead them with the light.
Yeah.
Okay, so I'll say, go into the light.
You can't write that.
Well, why not?
Think about it.
Oh, no.
Okay. How about walk in the light?
Wait.
Walk in the light.
I think we walk in the light. Follow.
Don't you understand? You belong here. Think of the things that you've done. There's no one to forgive you. Thieves, slanderers, your dark, twisted, evil thoughts, your wretched words that have destroyed relationships. The light cannot help you. You are wicked. You lie. You slander. Don't you see? There is no escape. You belong in this realm of darkness. All your thoughts, your words, your actions have led you to this place. And now,
There is nothing that you can do. You don't have the power to escape.
I am the light of the world.
He is the light of the world.
He is the light of the world. The light.
No.
Brooke, we have to follow the light.
No. What are you doing? Where are you going? The light won't help you. You don't deserve light. You must remain in darkness.
Passage from Ephesians chapter 2. Once you were dead because of your disobedience and your many sins, you used to live in sin just like the rest of the world, obeying the devil, the commander of the powers of the unseen world. He is the spirit at work in the hearts of those who refuse to obey God. All of us used to live that way, following the passionate desires and inclinations of our sinful nature. By our very nature, we were subject to God's anger, just like everyone else. But God is so rich in mercy, and he loved us so much that even though we were dead because of our sins, he gave us life when he raised Christ from the dead. It is only by God's grace that you have been saved, for he raised us from the dead along with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms because we are united with Christ Jesus. So God can point to all of us in future ages as examples of the incredible wealth of his grace and kindness towards us, as shown in all the things that he has done for us who are united with Christ Jesus. God saved you by his grace when you believed, and you can't take credit for this. It's a gift from God. Salvation is not a reward for the good things that we have done, so none of us can boast about it, for we are God's masterpiece. He has created us anew in Christ Jesus, so we can do the good things that he has planned for us long ago. Have you ever wondered what captures our attention so much about shows like Stranger Things? For me, I think it's the suspense. Whether or not you are a Stranger Things fan, whether Stranger Things is your thing or not, we've all seen the same sort of plot. The thing that drives Stranger Things is the suspense. Is this, the suspense is driven really by this battle between the upside down, this world of darkness, this world of evil, and the good, this world of light, the world that we see all around us. And whether or not you've ever seen Stranger Things, you've seen that same plot worked out in every movie and everything that's like suspenseful on a screen that you've ever seen. It's this idea, this plot where somebody, everything is good, where everything is just the way that it should be. And then somebody makes a mistake. Something bad happens, and it unleashes all of these other bad events that keep on happening throughout the entire thing. And it's up to the hero to come and save the day. And the thing that keeps us glued to the screen, the thing that keeps us so captivated by these stories, is that hope, is that wonder whether the good guys are going to get out in time or not. And you know, that's the same thing with this reading that I just read to you in Ephesians. It's that same suspense. It's the suspense that there once was this good world, this perfect world, which is created exactly as it should be. But then someone made a mistake. Someone entered sin into the world, and bad things continued to start happening. And so now we have sort of two realities. We still have this world which is good, which is worth us caring for, which we should care for, but also we have this other reality. This other reality where sin and darkness rule, where heartache and pain are realities that we have to deal with in our own stories. But you know, there's something that's very different about this story. This story actually goes down a lot differently than the ones we see on the screen. Because in this story, it's grace that saves. It's not our own actions. It's not our own self-sacrifice. It's not even our own abundance of love that saves. But rather, it's Jesus. It's his love that saves. It's his grace that saves us. In fact, Paul, who writes this letter to the Ephesians, he goes so far as to say that it's nothing that we could do. He says that we were completely dead. We weren't just like backed into a corner with our backs up against the wall and we somehow figured out how to narrowly escape. No, he says that we were completely dead, unable to do anything without the life that we have been given in Christ. And that right there is grace. But there's a bigger difference to this reading in Ephesians. It's actually the point where we're at in the story right now. Because if you remember, I did not read, but God is so rich in mercy and he loved us so much that even though we were dead because of our sins, he gave us life when he raised Christ from the dead, and we all lived happily ever after, the end, right? No, the story continues. The story keeps going. And thanks be to God for that, because our stories are still being written. So maybe you picked up on it from our little skit that we did this morning. But the theme for this school year is going to be examples of grace. And that theme is really rooted in this idea that we read about here in Ephesians chapter 2. It's rooted in this idea that Christ is the hero of each and every one of our stories. That God is so rich in love and so rich in mercy that he gave up his one and only Son that you and I might be able to live with him. All so that we can be, so that God can point to us in all future ages as examples of the incredible wealth of his grace and kindness. You see, that's what we get to be. We get to be examples of grace because Jesus has already called us out of darkness and into light, because he has called us out of death and into life. We have experienced his grace in abundance because of what Jesus has done for us. We have experienced his love in abundance. And that means that all of our lives are dictated, are defined by grace. And a life that is defined by grace is one that should always reflect the great abundance of love that God has for you and for me. You know, there's something really special about, really unique about a day like today, about a school year sort of schedule. And maybe you don't realize this, maybe we don't realize this because we've never really known anything different. This is just sort of part of our rhythm to life. But there's something so special about a day like today, the first day of school. It's a day that gets to be marked with change and with new beginnings. For some of you, this day is the start of a new chapter. For you freshmen, this is your first day of high school. And that opens up this new chapter to a bunch of new experiences that you get to have. For some of you seniors, this is your last first day of high school, which means it's sort of the beginning of an end of an era. But there is some really sweet things that get to happen throughout this year for you. For others of you, today is just the next step of a new grade, a new age, which means new expectations and new challenges that come along with it. Some of us are stepping into new roles, stepping into new routines and new rhythms that we need to get used to. Some of you, this is your first day at a new school, and you need to figure out how to do life here at Concordia. And all of those changes, all of those new beginnings, they come with a lot of different emotions. Everything ranging from fear to excitement, from anxiety to joy. But in the midst of all of those emotions, let's not lose sight of what a cool opportunity a day like today gives us. A day like today, we get to come together as a new body. A new definition of what the body of Concordia Academy looks like. And on a day like today, we get a new start. We get a clean slate. We get a fresh beginning to be able to proclaim today that each and every one of us, that this body of Concordia Academy is an example of grace. A day like today also means that in the next couple of weeks, we're going to hear a lot about how we do life together here at Concordia. It means that we're going to have assemblies and meetings and discussions in class about how we're supposed to act in the classroom, how we're supposed to act in the hallways, when you should be on your phones and when you shouldn't be on your phones. We're going to talk about how we're expected to treat each other at sporting events or how we're expected to act in chapel. And I'm going to tell you right now, the temptation is going to be that we look at all of these different little details as unimportant, as just a bunch of little things that are arbitrary rules. But I want to invite you, I want to challenge you to see all of those little things as opportunities for us to be examples of grace. Because those are the most consistent ways that we get to show and reflect God's love. You know, oftentimes we get caught up in looking for those big gestures, those grandiose gestures of faith. And those are what we strive for. Those are what we define ourselves by. But the reality is that God gives us so many little opportunities. And the reality is that is all God needs, is those little opportunities to reflect grace into this place. And so that is my prayer for you today. For my prayer for you for this entire school year is that you would be an example of grace. If for no other reason than that you would know a little bit more the love that Jesus has for you, the grace that God has for you that has been revealed in Jesus Christ. That no matter what your background is, no matter what your experiences are, no matter what your baggage or your belief or your convictions, no matter what your hopes or dreams are, no matter what your habits or your addictions have been, wherever it is that you are at, that you would come to know the love of Christ, which is revealed in Jesus, which is revealed in a Savior who came to this world and loved us so much that he poured out his blood for you and for me. I pray that you would know that more today and tomorrow and throughout this entire year than you do when you walked in to chapel today. That's what it means. That's what it looks like to be an example of grace. And that's how God uses us to be his examples of grace. And friends, that's why we love to gather together here, to remind each other of the grace that he has in our life, to remind each other that we are a body who gathers around the truth, that gathers around the love that Jesus has for you and for me. And most of all, to gather around the victory that he has had over death and the grave. So let's be examples of grace, that Concordia Academy can continue this year to be an example of grace. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you so much for the grace that you have for each and every one of us. I thank you for the grace that you poured out in each and every one of our lives when you sent your Son to this world to save us. Father, I thank you that the suspense is over, the victory has been won, and that we look forward to a new future, a new world in which you make all things new. Help us, each and every one of us, to proclaim that throughout this school, throughout our homes, in our families, in our activities that we do, in our jobs, whatever area of life that we are called to, Father, I pray that you would allow us to proclaim your grace and love and truth. Father, as we begin this new school year, I pray that you would challenge us. Challenge us to see the different examples of grace that we can be, the different examples of grace that others are being to us, that we can show others to the light. And Father, we know that through all of it, you will continue to allow us to grow in grace, to allow us to grow in faith toward you and in love toward one another. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.